Thank you, Shimon. And I think that you give a lot of hope for kids in the future. And the last inning, where is David? Yeah. So we have David as our last speaker. David Harel is a professor of computer science at the Weizmann Institute, having served as dean of its faculty of mathematics and computer science. He's now vice president of Israel Academy, and so I mentioned the one institute, and he won the Israel Prize, that's one disease. So, please.
Thank you. So just one correction. You should not have said last speaker, because there is a story about two Russians who meet in the Red Square, and one of them says to the other, why didn't you come to the last meeting of the party? He said, if I knew it was the last meeting, I would have come. So I'm going to speak about programming languages, but there'll also be a touch from the languages of nature and a slightly larger touch from languages of humans. I just broke this. Okay. Not yet. I'll try. So as a couple of people said earlier, the languages we use for programming must be endowed with a formal syntax, formal semantics, and we have to do that in order to unambiguously give rise to the phenotype, which is the functionality, which in our case is that these programs have to be runnable on a computer, so we have to have full executability. I'm going to give you a very, very brief, maybe 1 minute history of programming methods. These are not languages. There are hundreds and hundreds of generations of languages, but just the very general methods. Once upon a time, we used punched tape and punched cards, and I'm going to try to bribe the chairman to give me another minute at the end, because I have a very nice story about punched cards, but I don't want to waste my own time on this. So, I just blackmailed you for that. So in the 1940s, sometime around then, even before, we used, not I didn't use, but they used machine language. If you don't know what these things mean, there's no way you can understand what's going on here. It would be very interesting if I had more time to spend time on what the level of detail that you go into in these languages exactly is. Then came assembly languages. Here things are slightly more clear. I mean, you have something like jump to the start label, move something to someplace, so it's a little bit clearer. Then came a whole slew, and there still are, high-level programming languages. This is what most programmers use today, and they look like this or like other. If you look closely and if you've seen these languages, they make a lot more sense to an average human being. As long as x is greater than 0, do the following things, and so on and so forth. Different approach, graphical languages, where this is not just a picture that you draw on a napkin to explain something to a person. This is a language, and it has the syntax and the semantics. This particular language is called state charts. It has states and events. And it might look, I once showed this picture, and someone said from the back of the hall, excuse me, sir, is this part of the problem or part of the solution? So it looks a little complicated, but people are able to understand these things much easier than many other kinds of languages. But what I want to spend some time talking about today is, and then what, after 1985 or so, and what after that? And where are we going, or where should we try to go, or where do we want to go in devising these languages for programming systems? So first of all, I'd like to make a disclaimer. I'm not going to talk about the kind of programming that most people are familiar with, which is computing. Addition, subtraction, computing the angle that an airplane has to take in order to make the correct curve. I'm going to concentrate on what we call reactive systems, and these are ones that interact very heavily with the environment or with other systems or with the user, and the complexity of such systems is the reactivity and not so much the computation. So you press a button, something happens, and so on. So the next three or four slides are over 30 years old, and I've used them hundreds of times. It just works, so I'll use them again. This is what the process of building a large and complex system, say a nuclear plant or a passenger aircraft, should look like. Everything is fine. It's on budget. It's on time. It complies with all kinds of standards, maintainable. And of course, the most important thing is the customer is happy and accepts it. If you look at this picture carefully, you'll notice that there are no people there, and that is because everyone is very happy and they're all beyond the horizon, mission accomplished. But this is not what the process of building a large complex system really looks like. It's much more like this, with all kinds of pitfalls and errors. And by the way, Ada, that gives some people a hint as to how old these slides really are. Now here there are no people either, but the reason is quite different. They're all stuck over here in this place, which you might call the specification gridlock. And let me zoom in. Someone mentioned levels of abstraction, which are very important in many of our endeavors in the sciences. So I'm going to zoom in and go down a level of abstraction. This is what it looks like in there. By the way, the people with sharp eyes will notice another proof that these slides are very, very old, because originally they were all men. And then I went over, I put some hair, because you cannot show a slide with all male. So these people are scratching their heads trying to understand specifications. And this resonates very well with some of the lectures today, which talked about vagueness, about not being able to understand language, rigor versus non-rigor, and so on. And the root of the problem. And so I got into this area, by the way, in the early 1980s, consulting for an avionics project here in Israel, the Lavi aircraft, if you remember that. And there's a reminder once again. And the problem was really a problem, again, something that is in very good correlation with a lot of the lectures today, was a problem of communication, at the very least. So here was the group of people who knew what they wanted or thought they knew what they wanted. This is the people who had to build the hardware and the software. And at the very least, they had to talk to each other. And there was a very, very severe problem of these guys making clear what they wanted the system to do, these guys understanding it and writing that down in a way that's unambiguously accurate for the computer to execute. Now, several people here today showed sentences. Made up sentences or sentences that were given to children or contrived to show to make a point, like in your lecture, speaker, that wonderful example with the down. I'm going to show you sentences taken from a real specification document. I visited a very famous chemical plant company in one of the European countries. I won't mention either the company or the country. And during the day, they had this roughly 700-page document full of specification of what the system should do when they finish building it. And I stayed there for 2 days, so I asked to borrow this document overnight, took it back to my hotel room, and I decided to pick out of this document one small sliver of non-trivial behavior and to write down in my notebook how this appears in English in this document. And I'm going to show you exactly. The only thing I forgot to copy down were the page numbers. I made those up. Everything else is exactly as it appeared. So very early on in the document, there is a section 2.7.6 about security, roughly page 10. And it says, if the system sends a signal hot, then send a message to the operator. Much later on, there is a section about temperatures, where it says, if the system sends a signal hot and T is greater than 60 degrees, then send a message to the operator. Remember, this is the document that the programmers are supposed to use in order to build the system that should not blow up and kill people. The third one is the real gem. So towards the end of the document, two or three pages from the end, there was a collection of about 20 very crucial facts that were kind of collected at the end, so you had them in front of you. And listen to this one. Word for word, symbol for symbol. Summary of critical aspects. When the temperature is maximum, the system should display a message on the screen unless no operator is on the site except when T is less than 60 degrees. Now, just like Johan van Bentham, I was also brought up as a logician, and I have never been able to figure out whether this sentence is equivalent to any of the others or implies any of the others or is I have no idea what this means. And again, this is no joke. You can sit here chuckling. A team of programmers, some of these programmers have 2-5 years experience in coding, in writing down programs. They have to take this document, and there's a guy who has to write the software for the the temperature signal hot, you know, when things get too hot. How are they supposed to do that, and how are we supposed to make sure? So this gives you a little bit of a feeling for why these languages, and again, Zvika mentioned this, that languages for programs have to be very accurate, because otherwise you're in big, big trouble. So this language of state charts, I'm not going to have time, I thought I'd show you this, were invented at the time to help alleviate this problem. I did mention that I was going to do something with nature, so here, if I were to click this, you would see a cancer tumor growing with lots of, you know, thousands of cells, and here you would see this visual language of state charts running this, but I would prefer to get to the other stuff on time. Time flies, which, by the way, is another wonderful, famous sentence in English, which has lots of interpretations. And now I'd like to make a point, which again I think is in pretty good correlation with many of the things that people said today. I would like to ask you to take this word "to program," which sounds so technical, and you know these people, they program computers, and expand the way we view this notion. I don't want to think of programming as me giving instructions to this thing in order for it to do whatever I'd like it to do tomorrow morning and the day after and the day after that. But programming is really getting someone else or something else to do what you had in mind. And the we here is we human beings, we program all the time. Many people, maybe most people in this audience, have brought up children more or less successfully, but we always try to program them, and excuse me for using that word, where programming is to try to get them to behave the way we want. We have students, we have employees, we have a real estate broker. We're continuously trying to get zulateinu, we would say in Hebrew, the people other than us, to do what we want. And it's not always the case that we program computers. And in fact, we do this in ways that are very, very, very different from these languages, even the visual languages, which are quite natural. We do not program our children by saying, giving them a program in assembly language or even a visual diagram. We say, do the dishes now. That's an explicit instruction. We can do that. That's a little bit like a programming language. But we also say, you know, do whatever you want, but be back home by 11 o'clock. And if you've drunk half a glass of wine, you don't drive. And so we give examples, we give constraints. So it's a very multimodal way of causing other people to do what we have in mind. I want to get away from the linguistic side of this and just think of this as programming, and we'll get to something about that as we go along. So about 17 or 18 years ago, a new kind of approach to programming emerged. And it is, we claim, much closer to the way people talk about behavior, think about behavior, describe behavior, or if you will, program other people. And the reason why I think this is exciting is because it's not just another higher level programming language. It's not going from machine language to assembly language to higher level programming languages. It's not just climbing up the ladder of abstractions, but it's a radically new way of instructing computers, and it's much, much closer to the way human beings do things. And the language itself is multimodal, not as rich yet as the way we would talk to each other, but it does include the ability to say, here's something I want you to do, you know, do the damn dishes now, set X to be, 125. It also gives you the possibility of saying, you may do this, and you may not, so you take your chances, do it or don't do it. Maybe governed by a coin toss or governed by some other mechanism, and significantly forbidden behavior. So in this language itself, in the programming language, you can say a certain thing is not allowed, it is forbidden. And this is part of the language. The magic of this approach to programming is in giving it semantics, as I mentioned at the beginning, that include unambiguous means for executing these programs. Because how do you execute a program where some of the things are things that are forbidden? And that sounds like you need magic for that, but I claim quite the opposite. I claim the way to run these kinds of programs is exactly the way everyone in this room lives their lives. Kaha. So let me give an example of not someone. Let's say there is a student at the university. A student is pretty obedient. And that student has people who he obeys, like his professors, his teachers, his parents, hopefully. He's an obedient guy. How does this, let me use a he instead of saying a he. Let me use a she instead of saying a he or a she. So this student, how does she live her life? I'll tell you how. She has a backpack on her back with several books of rules that include all the rules relevant to her existence. Maybe the Ten Commandments, or maybe some Christian doctrine, or whatever. Maybe the rules of the municipality of Jerusalem, if she's a student in Jerusalem. The rules, whatever they are and however they expand, of the glorious state of Israel. And all kinds of other stuff. And how does she live her life? Well, she's obedient. So say you are her parent or her teacher, and you tell her to do something. Say, please put on this hat. Will she do it or will she not? Well, that depends. She will probably do it because she's obedient, but she will first check to see if this contradicts something in her books of rules. Because, you know, maybe on a Monday afternoon, if I have had lunch but I haven't had dinner, I'm not allowed to put anything on my head. So I don't do it. So, but if she can do it, she will do it because she's obedient. But then she will say, just hang on 1 minute until you ask me to do something else. I just want to check if there's something this entails, because there might be something in this book that says that if you have your hat on and it's not Wednesday and you know whatever, then there's something else I have to do, like lift up my right arm. And this is how we live our lives. We do what we have to do. We do not do what we're not supposed to do, what we're forbidden to do, and all the other things we do or we don't do based on some heuristics, some personality traits. And this is how this language actually operates. I will not have time to get into the details of it, but in this language, things look roughly like this. There are blue things and red things. The blue things can happen. The red things have to happen. There's a way of saying that things are not allowed to happen also. And this very, very briefly gives you a scenario of a quick dial in a cellular telephone. If the user clicks star and then clicks something on the keyboard and then clicks send, this is all kind of an if. Doesn't have to happen, it's blue. Then you have to retrieve the number, and three times you try to send out a signal and so on. This is what it looks like, so it's a visual language. But what's more important for my talk here is that this is a language of scenarios. So this is one scenario, and you throw this into the bucket, and then you do another scenario that says how the telephone connects to some other telephone. And then there's some things that are not allowed to occur, like when the telephone rings, no matter how often you press the star button, nothing will happen. You throw that into the... And this is the books of rules that constitute the program that this system will carry out when executed. And the magic of the execution is what I said earlier. It does everything it has to do. It never does anything it's not supposed to do. And the other stuff it does according to all kinds of mechanisms that I will not get into. But what I do want to do here and spend a few minutes on is to talk about... How do you write these programs? So this is the language, but how's the discourse carried out? Which in our world is not how I say something or how I write down something, but how do I prepare this program that consists of all these scenarios so that I'm done and I can run the program? So of course, there's one obvious way to do this, is you construct the chart directly. You have a graphical editor, you draw these arrows, you write down the names of the objects, and you know the user, the keyboard, the button, whatever, and you have these maybe these icons that give you these loops, all kinds of ways to do this. This is quite obvious. This is the way you would draw something in these earlier visual languages like state charts, and you produce the language, the program in the language directly. In a, another idea that came up around the early 2000s, which we call play in. And this is actually play in as a play on words from play out. Because in English you say, I play out a scenario. Okay, I'm going to show you how I now turn off the screen and point the green laser into the... So I show you how I do this. This is playing out a scenario on a system that already exists. What we do here is we have the ability, and I will not demonstrate this now, to play in an unknown scenario for a system that doesn't exist yet. So, for example, supposing that this is not yet what we know that it is, which is one of these devices that makes slides go back and forth and also can darken the screen, I think, yeah, and laser, I can burn someone's eye out with the laser. So this is what we know. But let's say it's not that yet. It's just a piece of metal and plastic. It has four or five buttons. And all I'm given is the local abilities of each of these. This is a button. I can press it. I can let it go. This has four positions. There's something that sends out a particular kind of beam in a straight direction. That's it. But now I want to link things together. So let's make it a telephone to make it more interesting. And I'd like to make it such that if I press this three times, it calls the police, for example. So I can do that by writing a program. I can do it by drawing a chart. But I can also essentially do it, if I have this on my screen, by clicking the things themselves and selecting the operations from the list of possibilities. And this is called playing in, and our system actually allows you to do that. You can play in the scenarios by showing me on the screen what has to be done. If there are various possibilities, you select the right one, and so on. But what I want to show you today is another method. And I've chosen this to actually demo because of the subject matter of today. I'd like to show you how we use English or Arabic or whatever, or Hebrew, in order to do the programming. And the natural language is not definitely not full natural language. I mean, there's a whole lot of mileage to be covered before we can do realistic natural language processing. There are people in this audience, I know, who work on that kind of thing. It's a controlled natural language. It's quite limited. But it's pretty, I think, pretty impressive. And I'm going to show you how we start with nothing. I don't even know what the buttons are. I don't know what the system has. And I just start talking. We won't talk, we'll type. At the beginning, what you'll see is we start typing and it doesn't understand a thing. What is a coin? What is a cashier? What is coffee? And you disambiguate. You say, coffee is an object. Coins is an object. Move is a method of that object. These are terms taken from computer programming. And at the beginning, you disambiguate. But once you're done and the sentence is understood in its locality, then this life sequence chart, this LSC, this scenario-based program, gets generated automatically. And it's a long demo. I'm just going to show you. And where's Shimon? I do keep my own. I never give live demos. So this is pre-recorded. I'll show you the beginning where you'll see us typing in some words and disambiguating, and then I'll skip towards the end where it knows most of the stuff already and it immediately generates the program. What I do want to emphasize, in case I will forget to do this while this is running, what is being generated is a diagram, is a chart in this language, but remember this chart is like a program in a normal programming language. When we finish typing and disambiguating, parsing, the system does the parsing, it translates it into this program, and you do this for as many scenarios as you want, the result is a fully executable program that has the system run. So we're actually programming in a very restricted, but yet natural language. Now I hope that this shows. Yeah, so let me make this a little larger. So, this is not very interesting. In the beginning, we just say what the machine is about. It's a coffee machine. It's a coffee machine demo. And now we add a new specification. We give it a name. And now look down here. We're just giving it a name. This is nothing. And I'm going to read out what is being typed in here. So now we type in something called insert coins. When the user inserts coins to the panel, should be into the panel increases coins in the cashier. Now there's many things here it doesn't understand. Ambiguity is displayed. Is this an object or a constant? And you click the appropriate thing. You can't see this, it's a bit fast, but what happens each time, a new element gets added to the structure of the system. So you're also the English, by using the English, you're giving it its structure. And this keeps on. When it's done, there's a lot of disambiguation even in this first sentence, because it's the first thing that the system has ever seen, that the computer has ever seen about the system you're building. But when it's done, create a new method, new constant, and so on. When it's done, you'll see the little piece of program here, the LSC, is created, which actually captures the executable semantics of that sentence. Let me go right now to the end, somewhere around here, I think, where more complicated sentences are being given, more complicated pieces of the program. And when we type in now, almost all the elements are already recognized, no need to disambiguate. And here's where the real difficult part of the work is carried out, where the computer actually understands, does the parsing, understands what it means, and produces this executable program.
How do you do debugging?
I'm sorry?
How do you do debugging?
Where are you? Let me leave that to the question period. Let me get through my stuff. It's a different way of programming. Debugging is different. Let me just say for your benefit, Uri, because I know your background, the programs here are much, much closer to requirements documents. If you believe your requirements document, then that's it. But the debugging can be done, among other things, by figuring out whether there are contradictions in the specifications and so on. But this is not the... But now I want to tell you about an additional idea, which we've done only a very little bit of work on, but I think is very exciting, and I would be glad if someone here wants to do a PhD in this area. I'd be more than happy to continue this. How many people know what show and tell means, this term? If you've ever been to a kindergarten in an Anglo-Saxon country or brought up children, so show and tell is when the teacher asks the pupils, the students, to bring something and show the class. What I did earlier, by the way, was show and tell. Here, I'm showing you this. You know, this is the glazer. This turns off the thing, and so on. People talk today about gestures. I missed, by the way, one lecture I missed today was the one on sign language. I presume there was a lot about that in that particular lecture. Sorry to have missed it. But people talked about verbal languages and gestures. And so when I describe something to you, let's go back to the analogy with human beings. I mean, we bring up our children, we teach our students. We use language a lot, you know, do the dishes, go away, but drive carefully, and so on. Never do the following. But very often, we don't just use words. You know, it would be terrible if I had to explain this machine to you by saying, you see that thing right at the bottom? You know, I want to point to it, but I'm not allowed to. And you know that if I press that, it does the following thing. Now, in the middle, there's a circle. It has an arrow on the left. The natural thing to do it is to mix the natural language, the English, with the gestures. You know, when I press this here, then the following thing happens. When I press this, but this is not lit at the same time, then that happens unless... Never, you're never allowed to press this while the laser is on, because it will burn your finger. And I keep mixing the language with the gestures. I'm going to show you a very brief, it's less than half a minute long, piece of this show and tell, where you'll see, you'll recognize at the bottom the same kind of typing is going on. But when the person doing the typing wants to say, when I press the cancel button, this I think is an example of an ATM, Kaspomat. And you want to say something very simple, when I press the cancel button, something happens. So instead of typing when the user presses the cancel button, you type when the user, and then you go with your mouse and you click the cancel button on the user interface, which is the play-in notion, and the English gets enriched with the words click the cancel button, and the rest goes on as before. And it's a simple, very simple demo, but I think this kind of work has a lot of potential. So, we create an LSC. Okay, when the user, and now we just go over here and we click cancel. And it clicks the cancel button. And this sentence gets passed and the LSC gets generated. And by the way, you can also say when the user clicks and just touch the cancel. So it's welcoming to several different variations of this. And when this is done, of course, the live sequence chart gets generated automatically, which again is an executable part of the program. And this way, we are mixing natural language with gestures. But human beings can do a lot more than this. And these examples are from people talking about building a healthcare robot, or maybe there is a version of the healthcare robot already walking around in the hall, and we're trying to discuss. Asaf Moran from my group sitting at the back credits for these wonderful examples of the kinds of things that you or I would have thought of asking or saying in the situation, but where we have no idea that how computers could do on their own. So we are very good at noticing irregularities and unexpected properties, such as, hey, this arm movement of the robot is not very smooth. Hear that strange noise when it turns, what's that? We are very good at detecting missing requirements and assumptions, such as if this is a healthcare robot for, say, elderly people, will it understand a patient who is has lost his voice or her voice? Can it process voice commands with the TV on? This is a subtle question because maybe there's a TV program from, what's it called, that program about operating room, ER? It's a ET, not ET, ER. Yeah, and then someone on the television screams, I'm suffocating. Will the robot, you know, start that kind of thing? Ask and answer very hard questions, such as, will a loud command from the TV confuse it? This is the example I gave just now. Why is it just walking around? Is it looking for something? I mean, we can immediately see that the robot's doing something like that. It might be looking for something. Programming a computer to realize that that's what's going on is much, much more difficult. And we use a lot of knowledge that we have. People mentioned things like this many times today. Sometimes, you know, we can think out of the box and ask a question like, I read recently that a pacemaker was hacked remotely by some hacking people, or so can this happen here too, and creativity. Let's see what happens if I ask this robot to fetch something, but I've just glued it to the table, let's see what it can do. And the reason for showing you this list of things that we are good at doing with the relationship to building complex systems, and that computers, no matter how good these languages become or not, is because that's exactly what we would like to do. And a long-term research project that we started about 2 years ago, we would really like this kind of two-way discourse to be possible with the computing environment. We'd like to work with the programming team, but with a computer that asks these questions, helps answer them, goes away on their own, checks things, comes up with out-of-sync ideas that we had never thought of, and thus turning the computer into a full equal member of the computing team. And, you know, if I had one more half hour, I could give you a feeling for how difficult this kind of thing is. It's not just, you know, let's devise another language, let's have some tricks, let's do some programming. This goes to the very depth of mathematical theorem proving, of learning theory, of data manipulation, data retrieval, psychology, understanding how human beings think. Linguistics is a tremendous amount of areas that have to be tapped into to make even a dent in this direction. What we do have already is a nice, shallow proof of concept for some of these things, which I will not have time to show you. Another thing that we have already is a nice name for this, and we call this futuristic approach wise computing. We did not want to call it intelligent computing. I don't want journalists asking me if this is AI, or why is it not AI, or why don't you do AI. It's not AI, it's programming. But it's programming with a lot of wisdom taken from, coming from, acquired from the way human beings do things. And we're working on it pretty hard. So I have time for this little story?
Yes.
Yes. So, it's a true story, perhaps embellished a little over time, but I love it. So back in the early 1940s, I think the first fighter aircraft in the United States that had some software on it. And so there was this team of three or four software, you know, programmers. I don't think it was even called software then. And you know, programming at that time, was, you know, these were gods, you know, no one understood what they were doing. And they had this room, they worked in this room. And one day, there's a knock on the door, and someone comes in with a three-piece suit and says, I'm an engineer from the headquarters of this project, and I I'm responsible for the weight of the aircraft, and I go from group to group, try to find clever ways to make this aircraft lighter. Every gram on a fighter aircraft is important. They say, okay. So he says, you're the software team, right? Yes. We're the software team. You are building the software that will be on the aircraft, not the software that will be on the ground. He says, yes. Your software will do A, B, C, and D. Yes, yes. So how much does the software weigh? So they said the software doesn't weigh. It's just the logic. It's the computer weigh. He says, no, I've already been to the computer people. I'm asking about the software. How much does it weigh? They tried to explain. He didn't understand. He got upset. He went away. 9 o'clock the following morning, they come to work. He's standing outside of there with his cardboard box. He says, can I come in? Yeah, come in. Sit down. He says, you went home last night at 5 o'clock. I didn't. I went to the security people. I asked where these people keep their software overnight, locked up. And he opened this cupboard, and this box, he opens it up, punched cards. He says, let's now do this from the beginning. This is software. Right? Yeah, this is software. You're the software group building the software. It will be on the airplane. Yes, it will do something. So how much does it weigh? So they didn't know how to get rid of him. So they said, you see, you don't understand. We only use the holes.
Thank you, David, and thank you for. I'd like to thank you and Yadin for organizing this amazing day, and I'll ask you. not yet. It's for Yadin to conclude. So.
Conclusion is very simple. First of all, I would like to thank the organizing committee, Ruth Berman, and Avisha Margalit and David Harel. And I would like to thank, something is missing here. That's the software, right, David? I would like to thank Nili for the support. And I would like to thank the audience for being a very reasonable audience, not throwing anything at the speakers, and even staying until almost evening. And we have this tradition already every year, having a sort of a multidisciplinary meeting, which in the background, you should note that we have an exact science division and humanities and social science division at the academy. So this is an attempt to try and to combine the effort, and the topics are selected in such a way that we'll be able to display and topics that relate to both. So we thank you very much, and see you next year.